1984. A woman arrives home to her Manhattan apartment and begins unpacking her shopping. All of a sudden, the eggs on her kitchen counter inexplicably begin hatching and cooking in front of her very eyes. As if this wasn't frightening enough, a deep, booming, demonic voice begins to emanate from inside her fridge. The woman is scared, confused, in need of help. But who's she gonna call? With the wave of popular ghost movies of the late 70s and early 80s, particularly Spielberg's Poltergeist in 1982, ghosts had shot back into mainstream culture. With the ghost genre being as broad as it is, filmmakers such as Ivan Reitman and Tim Burton began introducing the concept of the ghost into more comedic, family-friendly movies, something that would throw back to the early days of ghost movies of the 30s and 40s, but while still maintaining those horror tropes from recent horrific classics such as Amityville, The Changeling, and even The Entity. Join me as we continue exploring the evolution of the ghost story and we review Ivan Reitman's Ghostbusters and Tim Burton's Beetlejuice. Welcome back to The Evolution of Horror. My name is Mike, and as ever, I am your host. If you're tuning in for the first time, then welcome. In this podcast, we explore and dissect the evolution of the horror genre by looking at particular subgenres across a number of weeks. We are currently in the midst of exploring the evolution of the ghost story, and this is part 9, in which, for the first time on this podcast, we're going a little bit more family-friendly. Less shocking, disturbing content, and a few more laughs. We're going to be reviewing, as the intro suggested, Ghostbusters from 1984 and Beetlejuice from 1988. Can't wait to get started. But before we do, here are a few contact details. You can email us. The email address is evolutionofhorror@gmail.com. You can find us on Twitter @evolutionpod or on Facebook. That's facebook.com/evolutionofhorror. There is also a discussion group, the Evolution of Horror Discussion Group, which you can find on Facebook. Please do join and you can discuss horror movies and the podcast with other listeners. And you can now also follow us on Letterboxd. That's where I'll be updating a list of all the movies that we're going to be covering on this series of The Evolution of Horror, and you can keep up to date and make your own little to-watch list. So you can find that Evolution Pod on Letterboxd. And don't forget, you can find us on iTunes and all other major podcast platforms. And if you get a chance, do subscribe and leave a little rating or review, ideally a 5-star one. And if you do, I will give you a very special shout out at some point on the podcast. But let's get started. So, joining me to discuss the brilliant Ghostbusters and the brilliant Beetlejuice is one of my very good friends. He's been on the podcast a couple of times before already, and he's back. And I think he's very excited to be here to discuss these two movies. It is my great pleasure to welcome back Rob Watts. Hello, Rob.
Hi, Mike.
How are you?
Very well. Glad to be back. Thanks for having me.
Lovely to be back. Thanks for being here. So last time you were here, we were talking slashers, 90s slashers.
We were.
One of our most beloved topics. So obviously this year we're talking all things sort of ghost movies, hauntings, haunted houses, that kind of thing. What are your overall thoughts on that sort of subgenre?
I love a ghost story.
Yeah.
It feels like there aren't so many ghost stories as there were slashers.
Yes.
There are slashers.
There's never been that sort of boom of hundreds of them. Sort
no.
Of. Yeah.
I think you've said in the past, they're always there,
but
not necessarily a proliferation of them.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I've seen the big ones, you know, the big recent ones, Sixth Sense, classic.
Yes.
You know, all the current Insidious-y style ones, The Shining.
Yeah.
The others, although it took me a very long time to get around to see that.
Oh, that's a good one. That's
it's
a gem.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
I don't know how I didn't manage to have it ruined for me.
Yes.
In all that time. But yeah, I'm a big fan. And I guess a lot of ghost stories deal with grief, obviously deal with death.
Yeah.
Which is in a much more kind of human way than
than
a slasher. Someone dies, they're out the way.
Yeah.
You've forgotten about them.
Yeah.
Death is a lingering thing in ghost stories, and which is true to life, I suppose.
So, yeah.
Yeah, it's sort of gets you at your emotional core a bit more.
Yeah, definitely. That's it. That's what it is, I think. I suppose things like slashers are always a bit subjective. Some people just think they're rubbish. Some people might find them scary. But I think there's something about haunted, like ghosts and dealing with death, like you're saying, that kind of thing that sort of taps into everyone, I think.
Yeah.
As I say, we've just gone through this phase where we've gone through sort of quite hardcore ghost movies like The Shining and The Changeling and The Entity, and they're all quite dark and serious and scary. And now it felt like in the mid-80s it swung back the other way and you started getting these kind of more fun, family-friendly ghost movies again, going back to the days of sort of the 30s and 40s where ghosts became kind of funny, farcical, mischievous, that kind of thing. We both grew up in sort of the early 90s. I remember from my childhood going to watch Casper in the cinema. I
mean, me too. Do you remember? Yeah.
Honey, what?
Dad, I saw a ghost. It was a real ghost. It was real life
ghost.
Slow down.
What are you saying?
I saw a ghost, and it had a head, and it was round, and it was white and see-through, and...
Honey, now maybe...
Dad, please, do not think I'm as crazy as I thought you were. I promise.
No, but remember, ghosts can't hurt you, okay? They're simply spirits with unfinished business, all right? Let's just see about this ghost, all right?
I think on the previous podcast, I said Beetlejuice was the first scary film I've ever seen.
Yes.
Casper was the first film I saw at the cinema that appealed to my horror sensibilities.
Yes.
Because it really is, in essence, a horror film.
Yeah.
It's stylized, it's really gothic, deals with death, grief, and all of that.
Yeah.
It might be a friendly ghost. There are some terrorizing ghosts, not necessarily terrifying. But
yes.
It really does like tap into that whole life and death thing.
Yes.
Casper, it's a good way for children to learn about death. It kind of glosses over the fact that death is a permanent thing.
And
it's very confusing with its ghost logic.
Mm.
I don't know what you've talked about in terms of logic of ghosts in films, but in that one, they can pass through walls, but they can't get out of Hoovers. They can eat food, but they obviously don't eat food. They can contort their faces into whatever they like. At one point Casper turns Kat, who's Christina Ricci, into both Mel Gibson and Clint Eastwood in The Mirror, which is very weird, but it's fun. It's got all the trappings of gothic horrors, and it's obviously heavily influenced way more than Ghostbusters was from those traditional ghost stories,
old school ghost stories.
And as a way, if you were going to take a child to any film, take them to Casper first, then show them Beetlejuice. I'm pretty sure that's the order I saw them, and away you go.
It's funny because I think we talked way back in episode one, like you say, about Beetlejuice was like the first kind of proper scary horror movie you saw as a kid.
Absolutely.
And we both had the conversation where I thought Beetlejuice was a kid's film. In my head, it was kind of not you know, for young kids, but a kind of family movie.
As did I.
Yeah, and it's not at all,
It's really not, because we discussed, I thought it was like a PG or a 12.
Yeah.
It's a 15.
Yeah.
And, it does look like it should be a family-friendly film.
Yes.
Like Tim Burton's visual style and everything.
Yeah.
But
it's dark.
It's dark. Yeah. You've got some dark content and some adult content as well.
Yes, exactly.
In a way.
Yeah, exactly. And it's the same with Ghostbusters, actually.
That's
weirdly
true. Yeah.
Ghostbusters is one of those movies I always think of as a very much a kind of family film, and I loved it from when I was a kid, but there are moments in that too where you're like, oh, that's weird to have put in this movie, you know.
Yeah, I think I know what
one
you might
moment
be
in particular
about.
Yeah, it's just bizarre. So should we get started? Let's talk about Ghostbusters from 1984.
Ghosts.
Hello, Ghostbusters.
They're real.
You do?
They're mean.
You have?
They're here.
We got one!
So Ghostbusters then. Well, for anyone who doesn't know this iconic story, I mean, it's written by Dan Aykroyd and Harold Ramis. It's directed by Ivan Reitman. And it's the story of these three, they're sort of parapsychologist professors working at this university. So we've got Peter Venkman, played by Bill Murray. We've got Raymond Stantz, played by Dan Aykroyd. And Egon Spengler, played by Harold Ramis. The three of them are struggling. They're struggling for money. They're struggling for university grants. No one really takes them seriously. No one really takes the idea of parapsychology seriously. Until strange things start happening around New York City. A woman who works in the New York Library discovers a ghost in the stacks. And when these three scientists are able to come along and not only see the ghost and help, but also catch it, they decide this is a great way to broaden their experience and also earn a little money out of it. So they begin their own kind of, what's basically a sort of exterminating business as they go around New York City killing or capturing all of these ghosts that are suddenly popping up all over the city. Meanwhile, we've got Dana Barrett, who's played by Sigourney Weaver, who lives in this big penthouse apartment, who is experiencing some very strange things happening in her apartment building. And it all turns out that this building is kind of the hub of all of this paranormal activity happening in the city. And it's all to do with this big ancient demon god thing called Gozer, who is coming to destroy the world. So the Ghostbusters band together. They have to defeat the evil, save the world, and get the girl. It sounds, in theory, just like a kind of superhero film almost, doesn't it?
I mean, it's the exact setup. You've got a group of do-gooders defeating the evil, and then it climaxes in them working together, saving the girl, killing the bad guy, and
happily ever after.
To applause.
Yeah, exactly. So what do you think of this film, first of all? Are you a fan? You know, have you always been a fan?
I've always been a fan. Yeah. I mean, I grew up with the TV series, first and foremost.
Yes.
I had all the I had the backpack. I had my favorite, the floor pack, which you rolled out, pressed down on a little
On the pedal thing.
On the pedal, and it opened. Oh, it was amazing.
That is brilliant.
So I've always loved it, and it's funny. It's very funny.
Really funny. I mean, that's the thing. I think, you know, first and foremost, Ghostbusters is a comedy film, isn't
it? Is a comedy.
I would say.
I mean, it came out of Saturday Night Live. It came from a bunch of comedians.
Exactly.
So
exactly.
They knew what they were doing in that respect.
But I think, like, the thing that they get so right is the balance of the sort of horror and comedy. And it is a comedy. And actually, it was ranked in the American Film Institute's 100 Years, 100 Laughs, you know, is like one of the best ever comedies. I think it was like in the top 30 comedies of all time and that kind of thing. So it's very much thought of in that way.
It is.
But I remember when I was a child watching it, there were moments that really scared me. And there were parts that I used to want to fast forward when I was really young. Like the librarian who, when they approach it for the first time and it kind of screams at them. And comes
She completely changes into a proper possessed demon.
Monster thing.
Looks a little bit like the Greasy Strangler.
Yes, it's true.
Do exactly as I say. Get ready. Ready?
Get her!
Dan Aykroyd was the one who sort of came up with the idea for the story, wasn't it?
And I think he wrote the script.
It was originally going to be him and John Belushi from Saturday Night Live who came up with the idea, right. And they were going to star in it together. And apparently the original script was a lot more kind of wacky and funny. And then they kind of made tweaks to it. And after John Belushi passed away, he kind of rethought the script a bit. Mm-hmm. And Ivan Reitman, who directed it, got involved and tweaked the script as well. And then they had there were all these other actors involved as well, that, you know, a big sort of comedy actor. Like John Candy was originally going to play Rick Moranis's role of Lewis Tully.
That would be very different.
Yeah, he was going to be kind of a bit more of a kind of yuppie corporate type and less of a kind of awkward nerd. I think it went through all these different changes and incarnations before they finally settled on the cast and the story and Bill Murray basically fronting it, who is kind of the heart and soul of it. Isn't
he's quite a strange leading man.
He is. He's always been, hasn't he, Bill Murray?
Yeah, and I think he kind of takes on the leading man role in traditional comedies and in, I know, things like Broken Flowers later on. And he's very dry, and that makes sense in the context of those films. But in Ghostbusters, it's computer animated extravaganza and an adventure. And he's just there sort of being dry. And droll.
I know, exactly.
Batman, what happened? Are you okay?
He slimed me.
That's great! Actual physical contact!
I always loved, when I was younger, my favourite character was Dan Aykroyd's character, of Ray, who is the you know, really enthusiastic, he's the believer, he's the one who, you know, but because again, Bill Murray is like kind of the skeptic, isn't he? Even though he is part of it and he is this kind of para-psychologist or whatever.
Yeah,
he calls
doing a
himself.
Great job at the start of the film.
Yeah, but basically everything he does is a way to pull women, essentially.
Pretty much, yeah.
That's kind of his main thing, his main sort of goals throughout the movie.
You wonder if that kind of leading man would you get away with that anymore?
Mm.
Is it? I mean, he's a little bit sleazy.
He is very sleazy, I think.
Figure eight.
Incredible. Five for five. You can't see these, can you?
No.
You're not cheating me, are you?
No, I swear. They're just coming to me.
So yeah, you've got like this brilliant cast, first of all. I mean, who was your favourite character?
I think it probably was Venkman, Bill Murray. But from the TV series, they gave Egon blonde hair.
Yeah.
And he has glasses. I have blonde hair and glasses, so you know, I couldn't help but sort of gravitate towards him. He was the most interested in the science behind it and the technology, yes. So I kind of like that. So yeah. It was probably Egon.
Egon was awesome as well, and very funny in that sort of super dry, nerdy way.
Absolutely.
Yeah. It's awesome. And then, you know, you've got the brilliant Sigourney Weaver as well.
Bringing that weight, that gravitas, yes. That horror.
Yes, exactly. By this point, she was already kind of a horror legend, really, just off the back of Alien and playing Ripley.
Take me now, sub-creature.
We never talk anymore.
She seems like one of those people that's just very game as well for being a kind of genre star, like gets involved.
Absolutely. And you read any interviews that she's done around Ghostbusters, she was just so happy to throw herself into being possessed by a demon and yes. and acting all sexy but also really sort of vengeful. And
yes,
it's great. What a great performance.
She's got one of those faces, Sigourney Weaver, that is, she's like stunningly beautiful, but at the same time she's got this quite, she could look quite scary and threatening,
yeah, very,
when she wants to.
Very easily, and she does.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so she pulls that off perfectly when she's possessed Dana, which also terrified me a bit as a kid as well.
There is no Dana, only soul.
What a lovely singing voice you must have.
Yeah, I mean, you were saying a minute ago how the scary bits when you were a child. And I remember thinking about when I watched it for the first time, the gargoyle demon dog things,
yes.
running around the streets chasing Rick Moranis' character,
yes,
terrified me.
Yeah,
and that scene of them with their red eyes chasing him across Central Park towards the restaurant, I've never got that out of my head.
No.
That's always remained there.
Yeah,
and it's still scary.
It is. Scary. And that moment when he's banging on the window and everyone ignores him, and of course that is a comedy moment, but at the same time it's horrible.
Yeah,
it's pretty chilling.
And then the next moment he's clearly been taken over. Like no one's given a crap about what happened.
Yeah, exactly. And that's actually what both this and the sequel have a lot of, is this kind of New York as a kind of very negative, people are allowed to be rude to each other, no one really gives a shit about each other. They're both really about that, aren't they?
Yeah, definitely, like, commenting on the state of New York in the 80s.
Yeah.
And kind of, I think it's even telling that the gateway to hell is in a penthouse apartment.
It's exactly.
Like, it's a rich person's like life that gets taken over.
Yes.
You know, the gateway to hell is just, it comes from the rich.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean, that's the thing. Like, do you think, because a lot of the films we've been talking about up until now, it's like, okay, they are about ghosts, but they're actually about something else, you know, like The Shining is kind of about ghosts, but it's actually about like an alcoholic father or whatever, or they're often about repressed sexuality or whatever it might be. I mean, do you think Ghostbusters is kind of about anything else in that way, or is it just about fighting ghosts?
Well, maybe. I think certainly comedy usually reflects the times, just like horror can. And the guys knew what they were doing around New York.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe there is that level of trying to take a poke at 80s kind of yuppies, like you say.
Yeah, I think there was a bit of that. And maybe just kind of masculinity. I don't know. I wonder if kind of these four like male characters, less so Ernie Hudson's character actually, but the other three, there are these kind of like quite pathetic kind of nerds, aren't they, really? Even Bill Murray in a way is a little bit kind of sleazy and pathetic. And Sigourney Weaver's character is by far kind of, and again, look at Rick Moranis as well.
Yeah.
And it's like you've got Sigourney Weaver in the middle of all of these quite ridiculous men, really, who's kind of the one sort of, I don't know, smart, intelligent voice in all of this, in a
it's
way.
It's true, and she is the strongest character.
Yes.
You look at it and you think, oh, well, the classic, the female character got possessed.
Mm.
But actually, in terms of the story, it makes sense because the demon wants the strongest person.
Yes.
And she's that person.
Yeah.
And the fact that Lewis Tully,
yeah.
He gets possessed as the key master or whatever. He's just a slave, basically.
Yeah, he does nothing.
Zool wants to be in this big, powerful woman.
Yeah.
Which Sigourney Weaver is throughout. She's, you know, back and forth with Venkman in the street, and she stands up to him, doesn't take his advances.
Well, that's it. You kind of, she knows what he's doing the whole way through and kind of rolls her eyes at him constantly. I mean, it's a bit sad that they do actually end up together, because I just think she wouldn't go for him.
She probably wouldn't.
But either way, it's like she's pretty savvy. And of course, the ultimate kind of evil goddess at the end, Goza, is a woman as well. And there's that kind of shock moment, isn't there, where they all see, oh, she's a hot woman, you know. Really 80s looking hot woman. Brilliant. But yeah, it's interesting. And then the other female character was the brilliant secretary as well, who's also amazing.
Droll again, deadpan. Because in my mind, Lewis was the secretary. But is that Ghostbusters 2? I can't even, haven't seen Ghostbusters 2 in ages.
No, Ghostbusters, no, he isn't.
He just hangs around.
He just hangs around. And there's a moment in Ghostbusters 2 when all the Ghostbusters are out of action. For some reason, they're off on some mission, or maybe it's when they're inside the Statue of Liberty. Do you remember that? But Rick Moranis has to don the suit and go out and try and save the world. But no, I don't think he's just like their lawyer or something in the second one. Okay. Something like that. Right. Yeah. But you might be thinking of Ghostbusters 3, where you've got wacky Chris Hemsworth as the secretary.
He is funny in that film.
Would it be okay if I bring my cat to work sometimes? He has major anxiety problems.
You know what? I would love to let your cat live here with you, but I have a pretty severe cat allergy.
Oh, I don't have a cat. He's a dog. His name's my cat.
Your dog's name is my cat?
And Mike Hat.
Your dog's name is Mike, last name Hat.
Well, his full name is Michael Hat.
I can't say that I'm allergic to dogs, so...
Yeah, that's all right. He lives with my mum.
Well, then we have that figured out.
So what do you think of the controversial Ghostbusters 3?
Ghostbusters 3 is okay.
Yeah.
It's not the same sort of film as the first one.
No.
It's definitely an out-and-out, we-want-to-be-funny comedy.
Yeah.
Just happens to have ghosts in. But then it gets way too bogged down by too much special effects.
Yes, I agree.
Again, it's the same with the first one. The ghosts really don't do much. They sort of exist, they float around, they cause a bit of trouble, but they're not killing people, and they're not really the focus of the film.
No, not until this Zool Goza thing that happens towards the end.
Yeah.
The demons, yeah.
But in the new one, the same sort of thing happens again, except it's even more of a big visual extravaganza.
It's
just ghosts everywhere. I can't really remember how it ends. There's a big portal that he dives into or something.
Yeah, there's a huge sort of New York, but it gets a bit Marvel-y almost in the third act, which is annoying.
Because we were just saying about the first one, it's a bit superhero-y.
Yes.
The heroes save a day, save a lady, blah. This one doesn't even try to be
anything else. No, it doesn't. And that's the thing I was most disappointed. Obviously, there were all these ridiculous hate campaigns against Ghostbusters 3 just because they were women, really. Which is ridiculous, because I thought, oh, this is going to be awesome. I loved those four actresses, all of them.
Yeah.
And, Saturday Night Live. But of course, like we said, Dan Aykroyd came from Saturday Night Live. A lot of these guys did. So it felt like it was fitting. But yeah, while the original Ghostbusters still had those elements of horror, this one just didn't, really.
It didn't ever try to
be anything other than a comedy.
It's quite a good way to kind of compare how much Ghostbusters 1984 adheres to kind of horror tropes and things. Because you look at the new one and it's not scary.
No.
There's nothing really about it that even sort of marries to the horror genre. Whereas in the 1984 one, you've got... They make the apartment building quite gothic-y. You've got gargoyles.
It's a scary-looking building.
It is, yeah.
You're right. The ghosts aren't at the forefront of this, but there were brilliant set pieces with ghosts, littered throughout. And, I mean, the opening scene, we talked about slight briefly, but I just want to talk about the opening scene in detail.
Let's go through that scene.
That incredible opening library scene. And again, if you just watch that opening scene in isolation, you wouldn't necessarily know that you were about to watch a kind of Saturday Night Live comedy.
Certainly not.
You know, when she's wandering around putting books back on shelves.
The old lady.
And you just see in the background these books moving from one shelf to the other.
That's such a classic opening scene.
It's just brilliant.
I think it may be the best thing about the film.
Yeah.
Just purely because you've got no background about what's going on.
No.
you just see some sort of paranormal stuff happening.
It's a proper sort of haunted house scene, isn't it?
Yeah.
And it's, again, it's that amazing kind of big gothic looking library. The library is like this big old New York building that also has that feel a bit like the apartment block, doesn't it? And it's really good. And the way it's filmed and the way that, you know, because it's directed by Ivan Reitman, who is obviously a comedy director, but he's definitely like tapping into horror tropes, the way that he films it, the way the camera kind of tracks behind her as she moves around all these corners through the stacks and everything. It definitely works as like a good horror set piece, I think. If there's something strange in the neighborhood, who you gonna call? So we should briefly mention the song, which was also nominated for an Oscar for Best Original Song.
Amazing. It's very catchy.
I think there's no one out there in the world that wouldn't know the phrase, who you gonna call?
and know how to respond.
Exactly. Yeah. Are you a fan of the song?
I mean, it's a bit of a classic.
It is a classic.
I appreciated it a lot more when I was younger because it's a very kind of campy pop song.
It is.
I did, however, a couple of years ago on Record Store Day, buy a slime green neon
awesome
10 inch version of it, and excellent. It's amazing. It's glow in the dark,
so, nice, very know. Very cool. Yeah.
I mean, it's a classic film, it's a classic song. I mean I'm not going to listen to it very often, but
no, it's one of those, it's, but the song is so like drilled into everyone's head and subconscious that like it's all part of Ghostbusters becoming such a brand, isn't it? Like,
yeah,
it's one of those things that you can't believe it's not older than it is. Like, it didn't exist before 1984, you know?
No, and I suppose that almost kickstarted the trend for a sort of for the marketing, because the song came out before the film,
yes,
and got everyone interested. The marketing initially, they were putting the Ghostbusters logo in adverts. In actual adverts of papers rather than in kind of like the film section and things like that.
Yeah,
so it's sort of a viral marketing thing. It's quite clever, really.
Yeah, it's a great idea. And like you say, you know, we all had like the lunchbox or the toys or the backpacks or, you know, I remember just Ghostbusters, you know, merchandise everywhere. So it was really, it became one of those things like Star Wars, like one of those phenomenons, didn't it?
Yeah, and that's not really something you get with a horror film.
No.
Are there many, I mean, you get based on the Freddy and the Jason kind of stuff.
Again, it was a very 80s thing tapping into that, like, how can we make money out of these franchises, basically. And that Ghostbusters came out at the beginning of that era. It came out the same year as Nightmare on Elm Street, and that was when things started going very kind of, money orientated, I suppose. Yeah.
I ain't afraid of no ghosts. We were talking about Ghostbusters as a family-friendly film. And I think for the most part it is, and we always say it's good for children to be scared.
Yes.
Well, I do anyway.
Yeah.
But there are a few moments where you're like,
yeah.
I mean, it's only a PG or a 12, and there are a couple of moments you think, what?
And not in a scary way, but in like a sexual way.
Yeah, I think that's the thing with both the films we're talking about today, that raise them from being purely family friendly to actually towing the line. Because you've got a lot of sexual stuff going on. So you've got Venkman and Dana, especially when she's been possessed.
Yes.
There's a lot of sexual stuff going on there.
Yes, yeah, definitely.
In the bed when she's almost just like half naked and writhing
and him. Panting. And yeah.
And he's wishing he didn't have to turn her down.
Yeah.
But yeah, go on, you talk about that one moment.
Well, there's one moment that really sticks out to me like a sore thumb whenever I watch it now as an adult, which is where, again, it's just part of a montage. It's part of a montage while the Ghostbusters theme is playing, the Oscar-nominated Ghostbusters song. And it's all about, you know, have you got ghosts in your apartment? You know, and there are all these like little ghosts appearing in different scenes. And then you've got, and it's Ray, isn't
it? Yeah, it is Ray Stantz.
It's Dan Aykroyd's character. And he is in bed and he's visited by a ghost of some beautiful woman, isn't he? Who then you kind of don't really see her because she becomes invisible, but she kind of disappears under the cover. And I think he gets a blowjob from a ghost.
Yeah, so she, all you see is his jeans get unbuttoned.
That's it. Yeah, that's it.
By this invisible being. And then the camera just pans up to his face and he's just like, ooh.
Yeah, yeah. It's like, really weird.
What the
like,
frick?
Yeah. And I'm pretty sure when I was young, I had a recording of it from TV, and that scene was cut.
I'm sure it was, yeah. I mean, it's classic.
Because I don't think I ever knew that scene existed for a long time, you know? I'm
no.
sure that was cut
I mean,
out.
It probably shouldn't exist.
No.
Not in the final cut, anyway.
No.
Come in, Ray.
Hickman! I saw it!
It's right here, Ray. It's looking at me.
He's an ugly little spud, isn't he?
I think he can hear you, Ray.
So you've got more brilliant set pieces as it goes on. You've got when they all go to when they become a bit more established as Ghostbusters and they go to that hotel where yeah. they've got the slime monster.
Slimer.
The iconic yeah. Slimer. And again, you know, a kind of, it is funny, but it's also got these kind of horror tropes where they all separate. They decide to split up, which mm-hmm. is a stupid thing to do in any movie, any horror movie. And we follow them as again, we kind of track around these long, endless corridors.
Well, what does that remind you of?
Exactly. One of the best ever haunted movies. So yeah, you know, and then there's that brilliant kind of face-off between Venkman and the Slimer,
yeah,
which is great, and again kind of funny and kind of quite a bit nervous at the same time.
Initially he's like, it's looking right
it's at looking
me.
At me, yeah, and that's horrible.
Like, oh my god, yeah, and if it wasn't a big green blob, you'd be like, this could be, if that was sort of any other kind of ghost from yes. any other horror film, you're like, wow, this is tense.
Yeah.
I feel what Venkman's feeling.
Yeah, and then the moment when it actually then just like goes at him all the way down the corridor, kind of screaming.
It's not even going for him. No. Just heads towards him, goes straight through and
yes.
carries on. It's like, oh, okay. He's not a malevolent force. He doesn't
no.
want to kill him.
Exactly, yeah. And you've got all these like, you know, again, it's a kind of became a bit of a trope with some of these ghost movies. You've got the kind of technology and science meets
yeah.
supernatural.
So that was a question I wanted to ask you because I made a note watching it the other day thinking, is this the first ghost film that actively uses technology, sort of late 20th century technology, to do things about the ghosts?
Yeah.
I don't know. I can't think of any others
well,
prior to that.
Funnily enough, the only one I can think of is very recently before this, The Entity, where they...
Remind
do you remember,
me.
You get all the scientists that have to like recreate
oh,
their
of
house
course,
in this
yes.
big warehouse, and they're like, we're going to freeze it in liquid mercury or
yeah, yeah.
something, or nitrogen or
I think it is, yeah.
Yeah, and
of
it's
course.
Basically... The interesting thing about The Entity is you've got all these different like sort of points of view. You've got this woman in the middle of it. You've got this like psychologist... And often in ghost movies, there's like psychology versus paranormal. So like,
well, that's
there's always one point of view that is, oh, it's all in your head. You're insane.
That's right up front in The Entity, isn't it?
Yes.
That's like for the whole film, it's
yes.
back and forth between
exactly.
the two. Although, of course, we know that she's
we
telling
know.
The truth.
Yeah, exactly. And that's the interesting thing. A lot of these ghost movies have at the center of them some sort of like, quote unquote, hysterical woman who is being harassed by ghosts and
yeah.
no one believes her and everyone thinks she's mad and hysterical, basically. And The Entity kind of plays on
and that. I know you've already talked about The Entity, but I love that film.
Mm.
And that, you really feel for her. Like,
oh,
I can't believe I just...
It's heartbreaking.
And the scene with all the men just sitting around the room, just basically
yeah.
writing her off. You're like,
yes.
come on.
It is horrible. It's so disturbing in so many ways, that film. But yeah, that's the only one I can think of where it's like, oh, they embrace modern day science with the paranormal.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you've got that. And I suppose you do have that kind of then tradition. I suppose it's a little bit in Poltergeist too, where you bring in the medium and the two kind of sidekicks who have... technology to track ghosts and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
You get a lot in things like Insidious and stuff.
Oh, of course,
but,
yeah.
But
playing on the
I'm trying to think. I don't think they actually have technology in Poltergeist for it. It's more like kind of using old-fashioned medium methods and seances and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, and so, okay, so it's not the first, but it's certainly the most obvious example of
yeah.
technology. But it's also, in contrast to The Entity, a film that says these ghosts... From the beginning, these ghosts are real.
Mm-hmm.
It's not in anybody's head.
Mm-hmm.
We, as an audience, like we know their job is to catch these ghosts.
Yeah.
We can see that ghost. Everybody else has seen these ghosts.
Yes. It is just a science.
We're not here to be scared by, what was that bump?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know what that could have been. Oh, I thought I saw something.
Yeah.
They're up front. There's a ghost. That's a ghost. That's another ghost.
Yeah, yeah,
that
yeah.
one's doing this, that, and the other, you know.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, all of these moments we're talking about, the librarian ghost, the Slimer, the fridge, they all have these excellent kind of proper 80s special effects as well, don't they? Visual effects.
Yeah.
That I think, you know, obviously do look a bit dated now, but I think were pretty groundbreaking at the time. And it was actually nominated for an Oscar for Best Visual Effects as well.
And you can see why, especially, yeah. They're all different colours, they're all different shapes. And I think, actually, they look better than the modern kind of CGI because they feel like they're really there.
Yeah.
They might not look amazing in terms of, I don't know, in comparison to the quality of the rest of the film.
Yes.
But practically, they look tangible.
Tangible.
They feel real.
Exactly. Yeah. That's what I love about 80s sort of practical effects. It's just everything just looks real as opposed to not, you know? It's just like, that they actually made that. There probably was a version of the Slimer that they made for
I
real.
Imagine
you
so,
know,
yeah.
Apart, you know, when it was not moving too much or whatever. And I love the visual effects when, you know, when that moment when it gets really kind of apocalyptic and the sky kind of turns red, you know, and everything is like lightning is coming off the top of this building. And it does look kind of very 80s, but it's really cool. And there's that kind of like very like 80s song. And there's that sort of montage of ghosts are appearing everywhere. Everything is happening all over the city. Like things are coming out of drains and taxis and all that kind of stuff. I love that whole scene. It used to be one of my favorite
very
bits.
Apocalyptic, isn't it?
Yeah.
And that's probably the most horror-like scene of the whole thing.
Yeah.
When it finally reaches its conclusion.
Yeah. And then we've got the brilliant climax at the end. So we you know, as we mentioned, we have this kind of showdown against Gozer, this like really like 80s looking sexy woman.
Yeah.
And then what is it? She sort of says whatever you think of becomes the thing.
So this is a classic kind of horror idea of you know, what scares you the most will manifest itself.
Choose the form of the destructor.
Oh, I get it. Oh, very cute. Whatever we think of, if we think of J. Edgar Hoover will appear and destroy us, okay? So empty your heads, don't think of anything. We've only got one shot at this.
So everyone's like, I think Venkman's like, everybody keep your minds clear. If we keep our minds clear, nothing can come and hurt us. It's great. So
I love
they
that.
Do,
just don't think of anything. It's physically impossible.
Almost impossible to do. So, okay, fair enough. Mm-hmm. No one thinks of anything bad, but Stance, bless him.
It's so good because it's like a second passes and she goes, it has been decided. Or something.
And
doesn't
say. Like, well, I didn't think of anything. Oh.
No! It can't be. What is it? It can't be.
What did you do, Ray?
Oh, shit.
It's the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man.
But it's, so instead of playing on his fears, it's played on something that he loves.
Yeah.
Which, in a weird way, is even more terrifying. So
yeah.
This cute little Stay Puft figure that he's seen on TV suddenly becomes, you know, the big bad.
Yeah, and it's amazing. And then you've got kind of callbacks to old monster horror, like Godzilla and kaiju movies and that kind of stuff, isn't
it's,
it? It's very
It's not
much...
like a tiny little marshmallow man comes running at them.
No.
It's a huge skyscraping...
huge thing threatening the city kind of thing. Yeah, and that's just great as well. And they're just really funny kind of like special effects in that scene where you kind of see its face in the background and it kind of, you know, it looks really mean and angry a lot of the time.
Yeah, how they make a big white marshmallow monster look scary, like just with the eyes. It's fantastic.
Yeah. And again, it pretty much is like it is like a symbol of everything that Ghostbusters is. That's like, because it is. It's kind of scary. It's silly. It's funny. It's quite kind of awe. You know, it's massive and it's visual all at the same time.
I guess
great.
You could distill Ghostbusters down into that one character
into the Stay
Puft. Basically, is what the film is about.
Yeah, that's
very true.
These men are consummate snowball artists. They use sense and nerve gases to induce hallucinations. People think they're seeing ghosts. And they call these bozos who conveniently show up to deal with the problem with a fake electronic light show.
And the only thing I wanted to mention as well, like you mentioned that, you know, most of the ghosts are not really that harmful. They're not really the bad guys until the very end when you've got the big bad. But actually, the closest thing that these films often have to a villain is a human, and it's usually some sort of awful corporate bureaucratic yeah. type.
Especially in the 80s.
Yes, again, it's a very kind of 80s comment, I think, and he's always like, you know, some suited awful man that is like, you don't have the paperwork for this, I'm shutting you down kind of thing. And he's always some sort of awful, weedy, nasty little man, basically.
And it's his fault that the ghosts initially
yes.
get let out. All the ghosts that they've caught
are immediately
expelled again into New York.
Yeah.
Because I forget his name, the ginger one with a small dick.
Yes, yeah, that's one of my favourite lines. So it's true, this man has no dick.
Everything was fine with our system until the power grid was shut off by Dickless here.
They caused an explosion! Is this true?
Yes, it's true. This man has no dick.
I think my final thought on it, after I saw it the other day, was how quick it goes.
Yes, it just zips along.
There isn't that much to it.
No.
You get a feel for the three main Ghostbusters. The film kind of zips along.
Yeah.
Like nowadays, that montage of them becoming Ghostbusters would have been about, I don't know, a 10-minute scene rather than a
Or it probably would have been a whole film, an origin film.
An origin film, yeah. And in a way, I wanted to see more of that.
Yes, yes.
In the context of the whole film, it was quite nice how this is what's happened, this is how they've got there, now they're going to deal with...
Yeah, it gets straight into it.
Zips along.
Again, when you're a kid, it's great, because it's just like, let's get straight to the ghosts, let's get straight to the good stuff.
And it's a classic 90-minute horror film.
Yeah.
Running time.
Nice one. All right, good stuff. So big thumbs up for Ghostbusters. Let's move on to another, I think, in some ways more interesting movie to talk about.
Definitely, and definitely one that fits into the horror genre a little bit better.
Yeah, 100%. So this is Tim Burton's 1988 film, Beetlejuice.
From the director of Pee-wee's Big Adventure, Adam and Barbara are
ghosts.
What's the good of being a ghost if you can't frighten people away?
Their house is being haunted by the living.
Maybe the house could use a little remodeling.
And they can't scare them into leaving.
They're dead. It's a little late to be neurotic.
So they're calling on Beetlejuice.
Beetlejuice, Beetlejuice, Beetlejuice.
Who's no ordinary ghost.
Yeah, you don't want his help.
Can you be scary?
What do you think of this?
Now, the party's over.
You want somebody out of the house, I want to get somebody out of your house.
But the fun has just begun.
It's showtime.
Okay, so Beetlejuice. So this was 1988, and it was directed by Tim Burton. I think this was maybe his second feature film off the back of Pee-wee's Big Adventure, which was a huge kind of smash hit that, you know, they then gave, I think, Tim Burton a bit more license to do his own thing for his next film and have a bit more control, and this is what he did. So Beetlejuice is the story of this couple, Adam and Barbara, played by Alec Baldwin and Gina Davis, brilliantly. I love Gina Davis.
She's amazing.
Yes, she's amazing.
She just looks like someone who should be in a horror film.
Yeah, she's just brilliant. They are this very happy, loving, sweet couple living in this very sort of quirky-looking house. And they're kind of on their own sort of stay-at-home vacation. They're on like a staycation together,
aren't they? And it's kind of, they're kind of sweet. They're living a lovely life.
They're just enjoying each other and their home. Tragedy then ensues because they crash their car into a river and come home and discover when they return to their house afterwards, soaking wet, that they are in fact dead and they're ghosts. And they find this book, don't they?
The Handbook for the Recently Deceased.
Yes, the Handbook for the Recently Deceased. And have to start adjusting to living life as ghosts. And then sure enough, their house is then resold to a new family who move in. And this is Catherine O'Hara and Jeffrey Jones and a daughter played by a very young Winona Ryder. So they rock up and this family, they're a bit monstrous in comparison to the really sweet Gina Davis and Alec Baldwin, who are like this perfect characters, perfect couple. This new married couple are pretty monstrous and irritating, and they want to completely transform the house, take away all of its kind of old, rustic, gothic charm, make it kind of very 80s and arty and redo the whole thing.
Gross.
So Adam and Barbara are just thinking, right, how can we reclaim our house? How can we get rid of these horrible people? So they kind of have to learn to start sort of haunting the house or figuring out ways to scare them off, basically. Because they also discover through the sort of going to this sort of other world that they're stuck in that house for 125 years, aren't they, before they can then move on to the next life.
And they can't bear to be surrounded by these... Well, it's really just Delia who is a nightmare.
Yeah.
But yes.
Yeah, exactly. They don't want to live with Delia. So who's this kind of wicked stepmother almost, isn't she? So yeah, and then they decide they have to call in the big guns, which is hire in a sort of a bio-exorcist, he calls himself, which is a guy to get rid of humans, basically, yeah. isn't it?
And he wanted to kill them.
To kill them, called Beetlejuice. But Beetlejuice is actually a psychopath in comparison.
Yeah.
He's a dangerous man, and I think, you know, Adam and Barbara just want to get rid of them and scare them. They don't actually want to harm them or kill them, this family, no. which Beetlejuice does. So as soon as they evoke Beetlejuice, they call his name three times and bring him into their world, into their life, they then have trouble sort of getting rid of him. And so it's just basically then the story unfolding of like this one family, this other couple, and Beetlejuice all sort of under the same roof and causing havoc for each other, really.
Yeah.
Is pretty much the setup. It's awesome, isn't it? I mean, like, when was the first time... So you talked about this in episode one. Let's just return to that. You said this was basically the first, like, scary movie you remember seeing.
It is, yeah. I think I must have been about 7 years old. Mm. And my memory of it is just the look of Beetlejuice. He terrified me.
Yeah.
And there are some very scary moments in the film. Mm-hmm. It's very dark, it deals with death, and it just stayed with me for ages. Mm. I couldn't figure out what it was about the film that sort of hung around, but it dug itself in deep. And
surely, I mean, we'll go into it in more depth, but surely it's just the sheer imagery, like as a child, like of those, some of those monstrous faces, they take their heads off. There's all kinds of things that are like scary for a child. It's like it's like child imagination dreaming up monsters or something. That's what it is.
Exactly. And we're talking about, in inverted commas, family friendly horror movies. And on the surface, certainly the visual style is family friendly, but actually, within the film, there's some there's decapitated heads. Yeah. Like you said, there's skulls. There's all sorts of horrible stuff.
Gina Davis' face getting ripped off as well. It's amazing. There's some amazing stuff in
it. And it's funny that maybe some of that was taken out of the version I saw. I don't know. But if I did see that, I obviously sort of gave that a mental blank and just something stayed, but
I mean, for me, because I think, and maybe we should talk briefly before we get into it about Tim Burton in general, because I watched this when I was young and I liked it, but it wasn't ever one of my favorites. And then I kind of in my head I've never remembered it as being as good as it actually is, and I think it's because of Tim Burton, and because now I associate Tim Burton with being this quite irritating guy who makes quite rubbish movies, because in my opinion, he hasn't made a good movie since like the late 90s, I don't think.
No, I'd probably agree.
And I forget just how fucking good he was in his early days.
Oh my God.
And I rewatched Beetlejuice about two nights ago for this, and I was blown away by it. I was like, oh my God, I think it's the best Tim Burton movie.
I would agree.
You know, everyone says Edward Scissorhands, and Edward Scissorhands is great, but this is just so unique and original and weird and scary and imaginative. Mm-hmm. I just love it. It's so good. But Tim Burton in general, I mean, what do you think? I mean, am I being harsh there? I mean, I just think he's got this incredible visual style, which was amazing in the 80s and 90s. He brought his, like, you know, unique vision to everything. But then maybe he just ran dry in terms of ideas or something, because then it just felt like he was churning out the same movie over and over again, but to a lesser, slightly lesser with each one, basically.
I think his visual style initially was so unique, and it was obviously very, very gothic, and drew on all those kind of horror tropes, even dating back to the what you would read in the original gothic literature and stuff, but his own kind of spin on it with like a kind of topsy-turvy style and kind of things like that. And Until the late 90s, he kind of had a reign of it. And then he sort of just, he wasn't making his own stories as well. He's not been making original stories. And I know Beetlejuice wasn't his story originally, but like,
it could have been, it felt like it could have.
It certainly felt like it, yeah. Whereas Alice in Wonderland, too big a story for anyone to
And also there was just, I think the problem is maybe it became more about his style over substance for me. That's the thing. He's one of those directors, I'd say more than any other director in the world, like anyone could tell you what a Tim Burton movie looks like, you know, like
how would you describe a Tim Burton movie? Because I can picture it, but I don't know how to actually
it's hard
that
to
into
describe
words.
In words
it's
it?
Like lots of curly black
I'd say first of all gothic gothic, but also colorful. It's like CBeebies meets gothic or something how I would describe it. So you've got these like bright primary colors of kind of green trees and blue skies and very bright yellow sun, but then you've also got weird, dark houses with cobwebs, and everything is at angles, at sort of diagonal angles, and characters often have very distinct features, like they wear bright colours but have jet black hair or black eyes. Everything is just like it's drawn in a colouring book or something,
yeah,
you know?
That's kind of, yeah, very kind of childlike colours, but also very cine literate in a lot of it's very German expressionist, like the black and white kind of corridors
exactly
that sort of fall
German
in on themselves.
It is, exactly. And again, we'll get into this, but you can tell, obviously, Tim Burton is a huge fan of kind of old cinema, old horror cinema, gothic, Hammer, all that kind of thing, I think. But yeah, you know, I don't know what, maybe it's because his style is so distinctive that after a while, like, you can't see any more of it. I don't know, I got a bit like, do something different, you know? These other people, like, for instance, David Lynch. I'm always going to use David Lynch as an example. But he's someone that has a very distinct style, but his style has changed over the years, you know? Like, from Eraserhead to Inland Empire, he always, like, tries different things and does different things. And even though he has Lynchian tropes, he still keeps it fresh and does new things and tries new things, whereas I feel like Tim Burton is still trying to make everything look like Beetlejuice.
Maybe. I mean, Alice in Wonderland to a lesser extent, but things like Miss Peregrine's School for Peculiar Children certainly feels like the atypical Tim Burton style.
Yes.
But again, he's just put that on top of someone else's work. I think if he wrote another Edward Scissorhands, a story completely unique and put his style into it, I think I'd happily see that, and I think I would enjoy it. I just think he's not chosen the right material.
No, like, it's the material, because he obviously has an amazing visual eye. Like, his films never look, it's not the look really that I'm bothered about, but it's just the fact that the films just feel repetitive so much, you know, and they're never particularly that fun anymore, I don't think, either. Like, dark shadows and big eyes, and I don't know what it is. It's something irritating about it. It's like it's quirky. You know, the one that I find really annoying is Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. But when you look at his run from the early days to like Beetlejuice to Batman to Edward Scissorhands to Batman Returns to Ed Wood to like that era of early 90s, late 80s, he was smashing it then.
I think
he was amazing. And I think it just had to do with like he just told the stories better or something than he does now. But anyway, I'll stop moaning about Tim Burton. And we'll talk about the brilliant Beetlejuice.
Yeah, let's do that.
So yeah, he this was his like second movie, I think, wasn't it? And
yeah.
And yeah, so you know, let's go from the beginning. I mean, first of all, the our sort of our main heroes, really, played by Gina Davis and Alec Baldwin.
Yeah, Adam, Barbara and Adam. Yeah.
Amazing characters, both of them. To me, Gina Davis is the true kind of star of this. She really stands out for me. I think she's brilliant. I'm a bit in love with her, actually, in this film.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
I'm so glad we're spending our vacation at home. I'm going to get started right away.
Hey, where are you going?
Beetlejuice starts with an immediate homage to another horror film, The Shining. So you've got the camera panning down the sort of the road with all the scenery, following the car, and you're like, oh, this is The Shining.
Yeah.
And then it does that amazing transition into the same scene, but it's a model.
Yes.
And then you see the house, and you're like, ah, this is pretty cool.
Really cool. Yeah.
So we're already set the tone of like, okay, I mean, it's appealing to horror fans, fans who know The Shining. Then you see the house, and it's like this big gothic sort of psycho house. You're like, it's all there, it's ready.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm in a horror film already.
Yes, exactly. And then it becomes, like you say, it's like then it becomes like storybook land where, you know, and that is the perfect kind of sort of representation of Burton in a way, isn't
exactly.
it? It's like old horror meets this new sort of weird style.
But it is interesting because it starts, you've got all these horror things, and then suddenly you meet this lovely couple.
Mm-hmm.
They're just having a nice time.
Mm.
They're having their holiday. They're happy to be at home.
And then obviously, you know, within that first sort of 10, 15 minutes, they die, and it's like, wow.
I actually like the fact that the crash is ambiguous because it builds that tension. Like, oh.
Yes, because they come home and they look fine.
And and this is the good thing about Beetlejuice, is it, unlike, you tell me if I'm wrong, but most ghost stories, you're either from the sort of human side of things, looking at it from the human side of things or from a third perspective. But in this film, you're looking at everything through the ghost's eyes, through Adam and Barbara's eyes.
Yeah.
As they figure out what the hell's going on,
yeah,
you're figuring out what the hell's going on. You don't know the ghosts till they realise they're ghosts.
Exactly, yeah. I think that is that's a throwback to old cinema, and this is the thing. You can tell Burton loves that kind of thing. And I think this is where we've gone full circle back to the days of, like Kevin Lyons mentioned on episode one of this series, Topper, this movie Topper, which was Cary Grant like kind of comedy where this couple are in a car crash, and then they sort of emerge and they realise that they're dead. You know, it's almost exactly the same. You know, they emerge from this car crash looking absolutely fine.
Mm-hmm.
And then suddenly they discover, oh my God, we're ghosts, you know. And it's how do they then live in their house or with other people as ghosts. So it's very similar setup to this old 1930s kind of... And that wasn't really a horror, Topper. It was kind of this, like, knockabout comedy.
Know something, George? I think we're dead.
I think you're right. It's funny, I don't feel any different.
No, neither do I.
So
yeah, kind of a screwball comedy.
Yes.
But it had that integral ghost trope, which is they're still on Earth.
Yes.
There's probably a reason they're still on Earth. What is that reason?
Mm.
Oh, it's to help this dude do whatever he needs to do, and then they can move on.
Yes,
and
exactly.
That's the heart of most ghost stories.
Yes, because usually they're all about ghosts are stuck somewhere for a reason, you know,
yeah.
The reason they can't move on is. And again, there's a great kind of explanation and world for this movie as to why they're stuck. It's great. You
it's interesting, and it is different.
It's different, so, yeah.
You don't have an appointment, do you?
Well, we didn't know how to make one.
Appointment for what?
What do you want?
We need some help.
Already? You just bit the big one 2 months ago and you want help.
2 months? What does that have to do with anything?
You're going
to
use up all your health vouchers. D-90s. You spend 125 years on Earth, actually in that house, during which you get only 3 Class 1 D-90 intercessions with Juno. You probably haven't even read through the manual completely yet.
Suddenly death and the afterlife has become this kind of corporatized...
Yes.
I don't know, like an extension of real life. It's not fun. It's not... heaven.
No.
It's just sort of another kind of bureaucratized,
boring. Again, it's really 80s, isn't it? It's that whole thing of like everything is like a business, or
so
whatever.
True.
Yeah. That moment when they kind of sit in the waiting room next to that person with like the shrunken head.
The shrunken head, the guy who's like been burnt alive because he's a constant chain smoker. And what else is there?
There's a woman whose legs are kind of apart.
A magician's assistant's been sawn in half. It's brilliant. And there's like someone who's been run over who's still got the tire tracks up him. Something.
It's great. And it's like, these are quite, in some ways, you could, you know, perceive them as quite horrific images. These are like proper full-on graphic, you know, death, victims from gory death scenes, but it's done in this kind of brilliantly comedic way.
Yeah, in a comical way, which is... why it feels like, oh, it's okay that children are watching this, because it's almost a cartoon.
Yes.
But actually, if you think about it, it's really not. It's really dark. Like, all these people are dead.
Yeah.
You know exactly how they've died.
And,
like, wow.
And
then they go up to the counter because they're in a waiting room. They're waiting to see someone, their casework, apparently, because obviously they don't know what they're doing. So the afterlife is kind of... They have a helping hand. Someone explains to them what they need to do. But before they even get to that person, they talk to the lady on the counter. And this is where it gets really dark. She's like slit her wrists. She jokes. If I'd known what the afterlife was like, I wouldn't have had my little accident.
Yeah.
And you're like...
That is
like, that probably went over the heads of children. Probably went over my head the first time I saw it. But that
totally,
is...
yeah.
Dark.
Yeah. And actually, this is where you just think, this is why Tim Burton is so beloved by teenagers. It's such a grungy teenager thing to love Tim Burton, isn't it? Because it is accessible and it is easy to watch, but it's also, edgy and dark, and it deals with death. And again, we'll get into this with Winona Ryder's character, basically, is like your classic Tim Burton fan almost, isn't
it? Yeah, she is, yeah.
125 years. I can't believe this. I can't believe they didn't tell us.
Oh, Adam. What is this?
That's the Lost Souls Room. A room for ghosts that have been exorcised. Poor devils. That's death for the dead.
It's all in the handbook.
keep moving.
I think that's another thing about this movie as well, compared to a lot of other Tim Burton movies, where you're just lumped in this random, quirky world. This is like, we've got these brilliant two characters who are like our straight characters who guide us through this world. You know, that's the thing. They're the closest thing really we have to the sort of the normal straight characters in this movie, who are the ones we're aligned with, and they're the ones discovering this world with us, kind of thing.
And it's interesting that they're ghosts, and they're not the scary things in this. It's almost reversed. They're the nice people.
Yep.
Sadly, the nice people die, and then the next moment, these horrible people move into their house.
Well,
a family move into their house, and the stepmom is just a bitch.
Yes, but how brilliant is Catherine O'Hara?
She's amazing.
One of my favourites.
One of the staple comedic women of my youth. Home Alone being one of my favourite films.
Obviously.
Beetlejuice, you know, she's just amazing.
Yeah, she's brilliant. And then, you know, as I've discovered her in more and more things, she was very much part of that, like, Christopher Guest comedy troupe.
Yeah.
Waiting for Guffman and Best in Show and all those movies as well, where, you know, they kind of do this sort of basically improvised comedy. And she's so funny. She's just naturally very, very funny, I think. She's a really good performer.
This is our first meal in this house, so why don't we all do our little private parts to make it a pleasant one?
Don't bait your mother, Pumpkin. As soon as we get settled, we'll build you a dark room in the basement, okay?
My whole life is a dark room. One big dark room.
And their daughter, Lydia, Charles's daughter, Lydia, and she is played by Winona Ryder, who is on my t-shirt today as Lydia Dietz with her camera and her black hat and her entire outfit in black.
Yeah.
But like you said, she is essentially a Tim Burton fan. If Tim Burton fans had existed at that point, she would have been one of them.
Yes. Exactly. She's a parody of a grungy, miserable teenager,
isn't she? But crucially, she's the only one of the three who can see the ghosts.
And another big trait of ghost movies is that children can often see things.
Yeah, children are the true believers because parents are too preoccupied or...
Yeah, close-minded.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I feel so stupid.
It's not stupid, Barbara. We're ghosts. Do you want to spend the next 125 years having breakfast with this woman? Moan louder.
But in this film, the ghosts are not the people who are...
The problem.
Sort of the problem, which is, I guess, quite a good spin on the classic ghost story.
It's basically Poltergeist in reverse, isn't it? It's this family living with ghosts, but instead it's these ghosts living with a family who are awful. Yeah, it's really funny and it's really great. And I think that's something that you see later on down the line again in more serious ghost movies as a twist. And I won't give away which movies they are or what the twist is, but that became a bit of a trend too, where it's like, we think these are the characters that are being haunted, but actually they're the ones haunting or whatever. And that's a big thing that comes about later on down the line. But this is just an interesting spin on that from the get-go, from the beginning. It's like, oh, okay, we're aligned with the ghosts.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's cool.
It's a great point of view.
Yeah.
Babs. Boy, do you know how to pick them. Let me ask you something. Is this relationship really solid? Do I have a shot at her at all?
Excuse me.
Sure. Am I overstepping my bounds? Just tell me. Come on.
We haven't even come to Beetlejuice yet as well. This is the thing, because actually... Beetlejuice is only on screen for something like 20 minutes of the running time.
Specifically,
of the film.
17 and a half minutes.
17 and a half minutes is amazing.
But
yeah.
He doesn't do much.
No.
Essentially, I mean, it's cool because he's got a cool name, so they definitely make it the title. Cool.
Yeah.
But, and he has a crucial role in the film, but he's really not necessary for most of the film.
No, he's not. No, it's a great hook, because like you say, it's a great name and it's a great kind of mystery, because it's like, who is this guy? And actually, you're still wondering throughout the first third of the film, who is this guy? You know,
yeah, his name crops up.
Yeah,
the caseworker's a bit like,
stay away from him.
Don't want to go near him.
He went freelance. Like, really funny. And it does feel like they just let Michael Keaton just do what he wants.
Well, I think they did, because I think Tim Burton didn't know who Michael Keaton was at the time.
No.
He got told, try this guy out.
Yeah.
Michael Keaton wasn't particularly interested because he's like, it sounds a bit too wacky or something. Mm. And then Tim Burton was like, you know what? Just do what you would want to do with a character.
Mm.
So everything about Beetlejuice is what Keaton devised himself. And it is mental.
It is absolutely mental. He is off the wall. And I think, again, like, strip back, it's basically, you know, it's It's like an awful... He's meant to be like an awful kind of cowboy-type businessman, isn't he?
Yeah.
A bit of a rip-off merchant, like, but just like a really extreme homicidal version of that, who is also... And apparently in the original script, he was even darker and also a bit more rapey as well. Because he's definitely got rapey sides.
Well, this is it.
Him.
So, we again, back to the family-friendly. Mm. Yeah, on the surface, it kind of looks that way. But Beetlejuice is a big old perv.
Yes.
He even goes to, like... a brothel at
yes,
one point.
Yes.
And you're like, this guy is, he's lifting up Barbara's skirt.
Yeah.
She calls then, him a pervert.
And then, of course, wants to marry Lydia at the end.
Who
yeah.
Is a teenage girl.
Yeah, yeah. And in the original script, it wasn't that he wanted to marry her, he just wanted to rape her. He wanted to have sex with her, and then they took that out.
But it's interesting because it was written by a horror writer.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And yeah, I mean, it could have been incredibly dark.
Yeah.
I would still be interested to see.
There is a version of this story that could have no comedy at all. Mm-hmm. That could be
bleak.
There's an initial scene with him, isn't there, where they kind of decide they don't want to use him, and they let him basically do his thing in this model graveyard where Michael Keaton just kind of acts for a while. He just like flourishes around.
Go for it.
You know, like in Blackadder when Rick Mayall pops up? That's what it reminds me of, where they all just stand there and let him do his thing, swoop in and then swoop out again, basically.
Yeah,
it's so kind of like that.
I am sick of that subject.
Oh, Delia, lighten up.
I would rather talk about...
It's cute, Delia.
And then there's this obviously like incredible standout set piece where they decide they want to try and do their own way of getting rid of the family, and they possess them around the dinner table.
Now, we got to talk about that.
Are you doing
work
this?
Work all night on a drink of rum.
It's the best scene.
It's what a scene.
Yeah.
You know, the combination, it's a basic, pretty much a distillation of everything Tim Burton's about in this film.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So you've got the ghosts doing the haunting.
Yeah.
You get them possessing the people.
Yeah.
But in the most hilarious way you can possibly think.
Yeah. And it's really, because it's a brilliant performance by Catherine O'Hara as well, because her face is going, what the fuck is going on?
Oh my God, yeah.
But her body is doing everything else. And even when she smiles, it's like the smile is being forced on her face and her eyes are darting around like, oh my God, help me. It's amazing.
It's just brilliant.
Before they all then carry on. And like, you know, Winona Ryder's character kind of knows what's going on and is just laughing.
She just steps back and watches.
Thing,
yeah.
Like us, you know.
But at the same time, you then get a really terrifying moment, as a child anyway, where they're all eating, like, I think...
is it lobster or something?
They're eating lobster
seafood
tails or something, and suddenly that becomes a hand, and all of them get their faces pulled into the soup by these gruesome hands, and it's just... It's a practical effect that looks fantastic, and it's
amazing.
It's hilarious but terrifying.
Yeah, and it just feels like with this movie, it is like whatever pops into his head, he just makes happen, Tim Burton. And again, it's like a childlike imagination of, and then the meal becomes a hand and it grabs them, and then this comes out of the wall, and then the face peels back, and then there is a monster behind it. Like, all these ideas are like something that I think that's what makes it so easy to watch, because it's just like you switch off your grown-up brain and just like enjoy the amazing visuals and like the creativity of it. It's so cool.
I want you to come downstairs. Delia says you can wear any sheets you want.
And again, and then this is like kind of links to Ghostbusters and this kind of 80s-ness of it, and also the comedic aspect that after this happens, rather than run away screaming, they all go, this is brilliant, we could make money out of this.
Immediately.
Yeah,
yeah.
And again, it's the ultimate like awful, monstrous capitalist that they all are, these characters. Mm. Yeah.
It's like being in an amusement park. Bam!
I didn't even know I could do the calypso.
That's more fun than us.
Another thing that's interesting is that this was pre the 12 certificate, and the first ever, I don't know if you know this, the first ever 12 certificate movie was Batman, was Tim Burton's
What's
Batman.
Okay.
So Tim Burton is the reason that certificate exists.
That's
because
so
he makes these movies that you know that kids are going to want to watch, but they're just that little bit too dark for young children. That's the thing. And when there used to be no in between a PG and a 15, it was like, where do you put Tim Burton movies, you know?
And it's
almost like he's the reason that exists, which is really interesting.
Interesting that Beetlejuice hasn't been downgraded to a 12A, though.
Yeah, I mean, I wonder if it would be now, if there was reason to, but
I wonder whether they release like a new... Blu-ray at some point, like a special edition or re-release it to cinemas, whether it might get a new classification.
I think it probably would now because, you know, there's not that much that's, it's not so scary that a 12-year-old couldn't enjoy it. There's no blood for a start,
which seems to be a big thing, especially with the superhero films. And there's no real bad language. I mean, Beetlejuice, I think, says a few...
It's the character of Beetlejuice, actually, isn't it? I keep forgetting about Beetlejuice himself because, there is the stuff that, you know, the strip club stuff, the sex stuff, the kind of weird child bride thing maybe is a bit off for a 12A, I don't know.
What's happening to them?
I don't know.
They're dying!
Well, they're already dead, they can't feel a thing.
The Dietzes and the boss and everyone, they're trying to make money from the ghosts. And then Otho thinks that he knows what to do to make them hang around or whatever it is, but ends up sort of actually killing them for good, which is a very dark scene. It's an exorcism, essentially.
Yes.
And you see Adam and Barbara's ghosts shrivel.
Yeah.
And another great practical effect.
Yeah.
It's horrible. It's really sad.
There are just countless amazing practical effects in this that, would just stick with you. I love the moment when they decide to make their scary faces as well.
Oh, my God.
Adam and Barbara, and they kind of peel them back and stretch them out. It's just amazing. I love it. And again, it's just like... It could only have been dreamt up in Tim Burton's imagination. You know, it's just so good.
And that's one of the only times that Lydia gets scared is when she sees Adam like that. She's like, oh my God.
Yeah, exactly.
Barbara, I can't remember who
she sees. It's brilliant. But then, of course, when, you know, it's that levels of scariness, because then Beetlejuice takes everything one step further to being properly dark, threatening and scary. That's the thing.
Exactly. So as they're dying, he comes back and he's like, yes.
Yeah.
This is my time to marry Lydia. He's the catalyst for getting Lydia and Adam and Barbara to living together in that happy harmony. So by trying to marry her, everyone steps up and they finally do their good deeds, save Lydia. And it all comes good.
And that wedding scene's cool as well. I love the lighting. I love the production design of the series we talked about. I love the kind of green lighting that comes into all these scenes as well.
Well, that's it. It's like, that's kind of Beetlejuice's colour.
Yeah.
He dresses in black and white a lot, but his hair's a shock colour of green.
Yeah.
You always know when he's about to arrive because there's some green somewhere.
Yeah. It's really cool. And, you know, you could just talk forever and gush over Tim Burton's visual style, really. It's just amazing. Every choice he makes throughout this whole film, I think, is just perfect. I think it's brilliant.
Yeah.
Fits it perfectly.
Come on.
Well, I suppose.
And you've got this great ending where they all kind of have to live together then at the end, haven't you, really?
Yeah.
Where they're kind of all unconventional, happy family.
But everyone's happy.
Yeah.
Delia isn't making money from the ghosts.
No.
But she's seen how bad it could be and is just sort of happy that she doesn't have to deal with Lydia.
Yeah.
Charles has got his one room which he can retreat to.
Yeah.
And then Adam and Barbara act as her parents.
Yeah.
And that end where she's kind of fully embraced the ghost and almost has some sort of supernatural powers herself, where she sort of floats up into the air and is just singing more Harry Belafonte, Shake Senora.
Amazing
ending.
Oh
my God, what a great ending. I was dancing around the kitchen like Lydia the night I watched it. Just like,
yeah. I believe you jump in the line, okay, I believe you jump in the line. You just leave the film with a big smile on your face from that ending as well. It's just amazing. She floats up into the air and everything. It's just brilliant. It's like just so much fun, so much imagination. But it all works. It never gets wacky to the point where, I don't know, it gets too alienating or weird or, I don't know, like everything fits the story perfectly.
Yeah. Although having said that, not 100% sure what that world is outside of the house. I think Beetlejuice says something about Saturn at one point, so it's possible.
Well, I just figured it was just a made-up, nightmarish world of, like, don't go outside because it's just dangerous. There's a big sandworm that's going to eat you.
Well, I always thought that sandworm was was Beetlejuice in another form.
Maybe.
Because, I mean, he's black and white, but it's obviously not him because he gets eaten by the worm.
Yeah, no, because it's not, because it's more... the bureaucracy thing, because they're the ones saying you can't leave the house for 125 years, and that's what's outside it, I guess. It's a weird thing.
It's
but
odd.
It doesn't all have to make sense. That's
no,
the
it
thing.
Doesn't.
You just let it wash over you and enjoy it like a amazing storybook. Yeah.
I loved that scene when he gets eaten and Barbara's riding the snake or the worm, whatever it is. Just like Jude.
Yes.
If we're gonna talk about like David Lynch, just for the change.
Yeah. And that's the thing, there are lots of cinema references, old cinema. We talked briefly on the podcast already that Tim Burton was a huge fan of Vincent Price. Vincent Price, obviously, who starred in House on Haunted Hill, which we've already covered, and Tim Burton's original film, short film, was called Vincent, and it was narrated by Vincent Price. And you can tell he loves horror, he lives and breathes horror. He made a film, Ed Wood, all about the guy who made all those kind of low-budget B-movie horrors and everything. You know, he loves that world, but he just adds that extra twist. I don't think he's as interested in making serious, scary films as he is in making these absolute kind of dream world-like creations.
No, well, it certainly wasn't. Dance it all the time. Work, 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 Sinora.
Work it all the time. Sinora dances. And I think that, like, when you look at this next to Ghostbusters, they're both amazing and they're both timeless, but there is something much more 80s and in that case dated about Ghostbusters. I think Beetlejuice can exist almost in any time,
especially because the way that Adam and Barbara dress it's kind of just
they're like
slightly dowdy and,
almost like old vintage type looking, aren't they?
And they could exist anywhere, even Lydia's school clothes.
The only thing about it that is 80s, I suppose, is Catherine O'Hara's character and Otho, and their interior design stuff.
Yeah.
But even that is so out there and wacky that it's not really. You know, it's like, it feels like Beetlejuice could exist in its own world and time and place.
Of course.
Just completely
standalone. Sort of, the house is in the middle of nowhere.
Mm.
It just exists. It happens to be there.
Yeah.
It doesn't really matter where it is. It just is that place.
Yeah,
it's a Tim Burton fantasy land.
Yeah. Actually, briefly, we should just mention as well the Danny Elfman music as well, which is so iconic.
Classic. I know that there's a great sketch online. I think is it Key and Peele or someone does a great sketch about like Danny Elfman being asked to write a score for something, and he basically just goes, I think it goes a bit like duh, 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 and it's so true, but he's kind of the perfect kind of comic horror composer, because it is kind of jolly, but it's also ominous.
Yes.
And it works brilliantly on top of that opening scene as well.
And it's kind of like mischievous is how I describe it almost.
Exactly, and that's what the ghosts are in this film. They're not, well, with Beetlejuice as an exception, they're not intent on killing people.
No.
They're not intent on scaring normal people. The people that, you know, but they're having fun.
Yeah.
And most of it is about fun.
Yeah.
And that's what Elfman's music is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And again, I mean, I don't want to keep hammering this in about Tim Burton's films, but it's just that beautiful, when he gets it right, it's the perfect kind of balance of dark meets light. It's German expressionism meets CBeebies. It's gothic meets kids fairy tale book. And it's incredible. And the movie is filled with those themes, you know? It's a laugh out loud funny movie, but it's also scary. It's got wacky, funny, silly, outlandish characters, but also they've got real, genuine human problems. You know, Winona Ryder's character, she's a depressed teenage girl. And even though it's quite extreme, it's like she's not connecting with her parents. She's looking for a family. And then we've got Gina Davis and Alec Baldwin's characters. And even before they died, you know, they couldn't have children. And that was a really sad emotional story point there. So, you know, the way that they all kind of come together as this unconventional family, it works perfectly. And it's reflected there in Elfman's music, that kind of that dark meets light, that comedy meets horror, that fun, frothy nature, but with proper meaty subtext under the surface.
The subject matter, the content.
Yeah.
If you look past the comic and what the themes of the film are about, it's compared to Ghostbusters, it's like another level.
Yes.
But how can you blame me, Lydia? Your parents make it so easy.
I know. But don't you have any willpower?
Willpower?
That little voice inside your head that tells you when you're doing something wrong.
I never do anything wrong.
So just briefly, Ghostbusters obviously spawned like a cartoon TV series.
A great cartoon TV
and
series.
And two sequels. Beetlejuice also spawned a cartoon TV series.
Yeah, that was a bit weird.
Not one that was as successful, because it was all about Beetlejuice, the character.
Yeah, I mean, it had a couple of seasons, I think.
Yeah.
But I think I did watch a lot of it, because it was around the same time as Bill and Ted got a cartoon as well, which actually was fantastic. But this one was obviously much more aimed at children.
Yes,
and Beetlejuice was just like sort of mischievous.
Yes.
He was friends with Lydia, which after the events of the film...
Bit weird.
Lydia's not going to want to be his friend.
Yeah.
And it doesn't even have Adam and Barbara in it.
No.
And actually, Delia becomes her actual mother. Yes. Rather than stepmother. It's all a bit confusing.
Yeah.
And,
no, not amazing.
I remember what it looked like. That's about it.
And there have been talks for years and years and years about a sequel to Beetlejuice. I think there was even talks initially when Beetlejuice first came out. And then, and then he decided to do Batman instead of
something
about
Beetlejuice in Hawaii.
Yes, in Hawaii. Now, like, all the actors have said they'd be up for it. And Winona Ryder has said she'd be up for
even
it.
Even recently.
And,
yeah.
What do you think? Would you want to see a Beetlejuice sequel?
No,
I don't think I would either. It's just so perfect. Leave it alone.
It's perfect. And it's not about Beetlejuice. That's the point.
Yes.
You know that a sequel is going to be Beetlejuice from beginning to end.
Yes.
We don't need that much of the character. Michael Keaton's performance is fantastic. It's absolutely brilliant. I mean, I know everyone says it is. It really is amazing. Yeah. Shifting kind of tonally all the time.
Mm.
Absolutely manic, you know.
Yes. Manic is the word,
but we don't need a sequel, especially this late on. Like, Michael Keaton's doing interesting stuff anyway now.
Yeah.
Winona Ryder's back. She doesn't need to retread old ground. Tim Burton doesn't need to do the same things again.
No, he doesn't.
Just write a unique story and
I don't want to see
it.
Beetlejuice with CGI and stuff as well.
Oh, God, no.
No.
And you know that would happen.
Yeah.
So let's hope that never happens, yeah?
Excellent.
Yeah.
Good stuff. Oh, well, it's been fun. It's been nice talking about two movies that aren't conventional horror movies for once on this podcast. It's been quite fun.
And considering Ghost Story's not my forte, family comedy films, horror tinged, definitely more on the street.
Yeah. Rob, thank you so much for joining me once again.
Absolutely
this week.
Welcome.
Where can people find you on the internet?
Twitter, RobWatts88. And my blog is outsideofadream.wordpress.com. And I will have updated that by the time you hear this.
Amazing. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And that's it for this week. Thank you so, so much for listening, and a huge thank you to my good friend and wonderful guest, Rob Watts. What brilliant films they were to rewatch and discuss. I hope you had fun listening. So let us know what you thought. Get in touch. The email address is evolutionofhorror@gmail.com. You can find us on Twitter @evolutionpod or on Facebook. That's facebook.com/evolutionofhorror. And why not discuss Beetlejuice and Ghostbusters with other listeners? Come and join the discussion group. That's the Evolution of Horror discussion group, and it's available on Facebook. And don't forget, you can subscribe on Letterboxd to keep up to date with what movies we're going to be covering next over the next few weeks. So you can find us there. That's letterboxd.com/evolutionpod. So next week, well, we've had a good few weeks there of discussing the big, fun, glossy American haunting movies, but now we're going back. We're stripping things away and we're returning to the nostalgic days of the old British gothic ghost story in the vein of Dickens and M.R. James once more. So next week, I'm going to be joined by an actor of stage and screen, and he also happens to be a huge horror fan. The brilliant Stevie Webb will be here, and we're going to be discussing all things Woman in Black. Now, when I say all things, I mean all things. This story is something that has transcended every single type of medium. And so we are going to be discussing the original novella from 1983. We're going to be discussing the long-running stage play that began in 1987. We're going to be discussing the fantastic TV adaptation from 1989. And then we're going to jump forward and discuss the Daniel Radcliffe Hammer Horror film adaptation from 2012. So get ready for some serious Woman in Black analysis. So join me then for all of this and more on the evolution of horror.